Hello, dear friends and subscribers. Probably you're all surprised to see me on this cricket happening show talking again. Probably you're thinking that this is the second cricket show for the day. As you know, the earlier cricket show today, I actually previewed the two quarterfinals. Well, the reason that I'm here, let me tell you, dear friends, subscribers, tomorrow don't look out for my cricket show. Because tomorrow, the cricket show which is to be done tomorrow is being done by me today, just for the simple reason that I'm off today. And also, as you know, I normally do my cricket show in the morning, as you all know, before leaving for office. So basically, this is a cricket show which I'm bringing to you, dear friends and subscribers. The reason being that I don't want to be rushing in the morning, so I'm planning to do my, and besides that, it's not a match, so basically it's only a preview that I'm going to do. So I thought that I'm just preponing it, in the sense, instead of doing it on Tuesday, I am actually doing it on Monday. That's the only difference. So I hope you all like it, and you'll also appreciate that I'm coming here and you know, just making up, as I said. Don't look out for my cricket show tomorrow. The cricket show that used to be done tomorrow is being done right now. So in this cricket show, what I'm going to really look at is, as you know, there are in the first show I actually previewed the India versus Bangladesh clash and the clash between South Africa and Sri Lanka. Now the third clash, that is on 20th of March, we will see Australia clashing against Pakistan at the Adelaide Oval. What a match that is going to be. And the other end, the next day, we have New Zealand, the co-host, taking on the West Indies, who have really, really proved a point here, even by missing their big names like Kieran Pollard, you know, Dwayne Bravo, and also Sunil Narine. They have really done themselves proud. Not only that, the team has done Jason Holder, the captain, the new youthful captain of West Indies, absolutely proud. And I'm sure West Indies would be happy with the selection, not only with that, of having selected Jason Holder as captain, as there was a lot of criticism initially, but finally things, for West Indies, things are really coming together. So let's have a look at the match between Australia and Pakistan first. So let's get on to the Australian squad. Now, Australia and Pakistan, as you would remember, the clashes that they had on a different terrain, one could say, in the United Arab Emirates, that was something pretty different, where Pakistan really dominated. Even though Australia won, I mean, the test matches were the ones actually Pakistan dominated. But I think this is going to be another beautiful clash, which is going to be happening at the picturesque Adelaide Oval, which would be the third quarterfinal of the ICC Cricket World Cup 2015. Michael Clarke the other day showed that against Scotland, he opened the innings and showed that he's in, he's definitely getting in touch now, getting the touch back, as he scored a very quick 47. So now we know the opposition is going to be different, the bowling is going to be, but at least Michael Clarke is definitely getting there now. And he's the one who will be leading the side, as you all know. Well, they have, as far as the batting is concerned, well, the batting has been coming together. They have that explosive opening combination of Aaron Finch and David Warner. Well, I would say that David Warner and Finch have not been able to really put on a very sound platform till now. So that is something which is very important. And against Pakistan, who are peaking at the right time, I think it's very important that David Warner and Aaron Finch really put together a very, very hitting partnership against Pakistan. Now, the other thing for as far as Australia are concerned is they have very good all-rounders. Glenn Maxwell the other day showed what a terrific all-rounder he is. In fact, he's one who can really smack the ball, and he will come up with some really weird strokes. I mean, Glenn Maxwell, and another thing is Stephen Smith, another wonderful stroke maker. So, in fact, Australia are pretty, pretty well stocked as far as that department is concerned. They have Shane Watson, the all-rounder. So, that's coming along well. Australia are doing very well as far as the batting department is concerned. Now, looking at the bowling, well, bowling is also coming pretty good because they have Mitchell Johnson, but Mitchell Starc is the one who has been really dominating the Australian headlines by bowling superbly. And even with his bowling, he has also put Mitchell Johnson in the shade with his style of bowling. As Mitchell Johnson has been less productive, but Mitchell Stark is the one who has been amongst the wickets, and also he has been giving the breakthroughs. He has been bowling some beautiful death overs, and then it would be supported by Patrick Cummins, I'm told. But I would rather say whether they are going for Patrick Cummins or Josh Hazlewood. That would be pretty interesting. Josh Hazlewood is also pretty nippy, tall guy, generates a lot of bounce, and probably Australia might be tempted to give Cummins a chance against the Pakistanis, probably to beat them for pace. So I'm sure Josh Hazlewood may have to wait, or probably they know that Pakistan are good players of spin. So David Doherty's place might go, and we might see a four-pronged pace attack in the form of Pat Cummins. But again, Josh Hazlewood probably might be the person who would be able to, be probably missing, because James Faulkner is back, and James Faulkner, as you know, you know what weight he carries into the Australian team, because not only does he bowl, he's there as an all-rounder. He'll not only pick up wickets, and he's always there when the runs are needed, or if you come in the death overs. James Faulkner is the man, he's the right person on the job there, even if you know, the number of balls that are less, but they require a lot of runs, they can depend on James Faulkner to deliver the goods. So that is something. But Josh Hazlewood, very unluckily, is also pretty talented, but he has to wait. And then they also have Mitchell Marsh, who is another wonderful all-rounder, who is also a very, very good hitter of the ball, and Brad Haddin, the wicketkeeper batsman, who is always a good contributor. So it looks like Australia are pretty well stocked as far as the batting bowling, and they've been doing well. And the reason they are here now in the quarterfinals playing against Pakistan. Let's have a look at the Pakistan team now. As far as the Pakistan team is concerned, well, the good thing that is happening for Pakistan, according to me, and I thought better late than never, that would be the slogan here, because Sarfraz Ahmed, I thought that, you know, probably he was really hard done by, that he didn't play in any of the preliminary league matches, because I thought, you know, always having Sarfraz Ahmed was a real... they probably thought that they could have Umar Akmal, but Umar Akmal was not a specialist wicketkeeper at all, and as you know, he dropped catches too. But Sarfraz Ahmed, after coming into the team, look at what he has done. The first match he played, he went on against South Africa. He went on to score, if I'm not wrong, 50 or 60 runs he scored. And then he also took those six catches, which was a record. That is something he did. And in the second match, he went on to his maiden ton in one-day internationals, which was a great side. He's 27 years of old age, and he's a wonderful wicketkeeper, a wonderful... I would say he's such a batsman. I mean, if you look at the last match against Ireland, I definitely talked about this in the Cricket Happening show in my previous one, that Sarfraz Ahmed is such a player. What one has seen is that he's such a player, if you want him to wait at the crease, play out the entire overs, he can do that. And if, but essentially, or naturally, I would say Sarfraz Ahmed is a very good stroke maker. He has a very good sum strokes. I mean, he plays it with authority. He stands outside the crease to the pace bowlers. He's a very gutsy person, very bold and dynamic guy, I would say. And I think this this Pakistan team is looking pretty strong with that opening combination of Ahmed Shahzad, who's also a very sweet stroke maker, along with Sarfraz Ahmed. And I think that would be, that would hold the key for Pakistan. If Ahmed Shahzad and Sarfraz Ahmed could really put a big innings there, I think this is a wonderful combination to have. And then they have the ever-reliable Misbah-ul Haq, who never fails to contribute as far as his batting is concerned. Such consistency he has that it's really, really, one has to really, really say what a wonderful captain he has been for Pakistan. And not only that, every time the chips are down, Misbah-ul Haq is the man to do it. But one thing glad about the Pakistan team now, things are all coming together for them. And I'm sure Misbah-ul Haq, as you know, is a very good contributor. And then they have the batting of Shahid Afridi. Shahid Afridi always a threat to the opposition when he comes down lower in the order. And then they have Umar Akmal, who you know, always I've always been telling that As far as his talent is concerned, he has not really performed to his ability. Well, one good thing for Umar Akmal is that he made his debut at a very young age. He's just 24 years of age, so that really gives him a sort of a real, I would say, an edge over a lot of players. And Umar Akmal, I'm sure, if he's going to play for a long time, we might see Umar Akmal really showing his talent. He's such a talented player, but unfortunately, at the wrong time, he plays some strokes and he really gets himself out. Now, Yunis Khan, whether Yunis Khan is going to be given an opportunity, that'd be interesting. I would say, playing against Australia, I think my vote would be for Yunis Khan. I would definitely love to see Yunis Khan in the picture, because Yunis Khan, just because of his tremendous experience that he has, I think Yunis Khan should be a certainty. He should be included in the team. Whether Yasir Shah, the right-arm leg spinner, would come into the team because the match is going to be played against Australia, one has to wait and watch, because Yasir Shah is another person who has been in the sidelines after playing that match against India, which they lost. We have not seen Yasir Shah in action. Now, the good thing for Pakistan, and Haris Sohail is also a very talented player. He can contribute in all the three departments of the game. And looking at the bowling attack, now Mohammad Irfan, who didn't play against Ireland, would definitely be back, and he's direly needed against Australia, no doubt about it. So Mohammad Irfan will combine with the fastest bowler in the World Cup, and that is Wahab Riaz. I mean, he has been bowling at 150 clicks, and that is really, I would say, really seriously fast, I would say. And Wahab Riaz has really shown that the amount of pace that he could generate, and so he and Mohammad Irfan, and I would love to see Wahab Riaz actually opening the bowling attack instead of Sohail Khan coming. I would say that Wahab Riaz should be opening the bowling attack against Australia with Mohammad Irfan at the other end, and then Sohail Khan is the one to chip in and bowl the in between overs. That would be interesting to see whether they have any ploy of that sort. I would rather say that Wahab Riaz is the fastest, because you always have to give the red cherry to the bowler who really bowls quick and fast, and I think Wahab Riaz should be the one to actually start off with the new ball. Probably I would even say that instead of having Mohammad Irfan, I would say the red cherry has to be handed over to Wahab Riaz when he's bowling to David Warner and Aaron Finch, just because the cherry is absolutely new and the ball can really fly, because with the pace that he generates, he can really make the ball fly. And that would be pretty interesting to see see how David Warner and Aaron Finch approaches. So I would suggest, or my feeling is that Wahab Riaz should be bowling in tandem with Mohammad Irfan in the starting stages. And then Sohail Khan is the bowler who should be coming in and chipping in, providing them the support. Now, Sohaib Maqsood is also a very good bowler. Sorry, he's also a very good player. Whether he'll get an opportunity, one does not know. Other than that, whether Pakistan are going to go for Rahat Ali or are they going to go for Ehsan Adil, I would say, considering it is Australia and it is experience, I would definitely say Rahat Ali should be the one should be playing. But well, one has to watch and see. But I think it's going to be a very good match between Australia and Pakistan. As I said, both are looking pretty strong. I think it's going to be an interesting tussle. Definitely going to be interesting, and one is waiting for things to start there in the third quarterfinal between Pakistan and Australia at the Adelaide Oval. Now, the next team that I'm going to look at, dear friends and subscribers, is New Zealand versus West Indies. This is the last quarterfinal match, and co-host New Zealand, you know, I mean, I did not even tell you. Co-host New Zealand are absolutely on a roll. They are firing on all cylinders. Even though Bangladesh was the first team to really stretch them to the limit, I still thought that this squad, led by Brendan McCullum, who is a very very dashing cricketer, aggressive cricketer. They call him the gambler because he definitely likes to take chances, and that's what he precisely does. He not only does he take chances with the team, he himself is a person who actually takes his chances while batting to tonk the ball first, and takes his chances there. Now, Brendan McCullum and Martin Guptill, and this is a match against the West Indies. Brendan McCullum and Martin Guptill open the innings, and they have been doing pretty well. But probably one is looking for a good partnership from Brendan McClellan and Martin Guptill, because that is something which has not happened. And I mean, either Martin Guptill gets out or Brendan McClellan gets out. Now that is something which is very much needed, and one hopes that against West Indies in the quarterfinal, this particular partnership really comes through for New Zealand, the opening partnership. And if the opening partnership comes through, you know what New Zealand could do. They can do immense damage. I mean, they have such lovely players in the middle order, like the very, very talented Kane Williamson and Ross Taylor, another very, very experienced bloke. And they are the ones who can really, really take this New Zealand innings to a great extent with their classic batting, especially Kane Williamson. Liu Cronshi, the wicketkeeper batsman, is also a very, very good bat. And then they have the... as far as the batting is concerned, Corey Anderson is there. Two good all-rounders in Corey Anderson, who is a hard-hitting all-rounder. Grant Elliott is more of a sedate all-rounder, one could say. And then the bowling. The bowling has been something which has been the hallmark of New Zealand's success here, because they have been able to bowl out these sides pretty quickly. So it is Trent Boult and Tim Southee. As you know, they are a lethal combination, according to me. And West Indies have to be really, really be very... They would definitely be wary about it, but they have to be really, really be very cautious when playing Trent Boult and Tim Southee, because they can generate a very good pace and swing through their bowling. So Trent Boult and Tim Southee have been having a great time in the World Cup. They have been operating as a wonderful pair, and things have been working. Mitchell McGann, the other day we saw that he leaked a lot of runs. So whether that will enable Kyle Mills to get a look in, one does not know. One has to wait and watch. Adam Minn is there. He's another very, very he's a very, very young quickie, and he bowls at 150 clicks too. So that would be pretty interesting. He could test the West Indian batsman there. And they have a lot of depth as far as the batting is concerned. And I think New Zealand are looking pretty much the favourites, one could say. But West Indies could still spring a surprise. You never know, because this is the quarterfinals. And West Indies, according to me, has already really defied things. Because, as I said, big names missing. No Kieran Pollard, no Sunil Narine, no Dwayne Bravo. And look at what West Indies have done. They have reached the quarterfinals. So that definitely tells you that West Indies have it in them. And West Indies would be hoping that the only double centurion in World Cup history, Chris Gayle, is fit. Because, as you know, he didn't play against the United Arab Emirates. And one would be hoping that he comes. And one feels very happy for Jason Holder. Initially when the team was selected, and one saw amongst a lot of experienced people, Jason Holder was given the nod as the captain. One was probably thinking, even I was thinking in my cricket show, that why Jason Holder when all these experienced blokes are there? But Jason Holder has definitely proved a point. He has proved that he's a good captain. And now I don't think there should be no greater joy for Jason Holder, because on his first stint as captain of the West Indian team and playing his first World Cup, he has got his team into the quarterfinals. And let me tell you, Jason Holder himself has bowled well. And he's looking good. He's really hitting the right areas there. The other day we saw that against the United Arab Emirates, when he reduced the United Arab Emirates to nothing with his four wickets. And also another thing is that he has also showed that his batting is coming well. Now the other good thing to happen for tomorrow, it will be very interesting. And I have a feeling that Johnson Charles, who was making batting look pretty easy on his first comeback game in the World Cup, I thought he should be the ideal combination to open with Chris Gayle, because Johnson Charles looks to be a very good stroke maker. And I think with Chris Gayle on the other end, if Chris Gayle could get into swashbuckling mode and Johnson Charles could still play strokes, it's quite possible that this West Indian opening attack could really get things going for the West Indies with their opening partnership. Now, the other thing for West Indies is that Marlon Samuels, who is a very classy player, as I said, you can never write off West Indies, because there's a lot of pump left in them, because Johnson Charles and Chris Gayle opening innings, Marlon Samuels coming in, and you know, he's such a classy player. And let me tell you, once he gets going, He's a serious bloke, and you know, it will really take it will be a lot difficult for New Zealand to actually stop the West Indies if Marlon Samuels gets going, because he's so sweet to watch and he's a sweet stroke maker. And then Jonathan Carter already has announced his entry into the World Cup the other day with that very well-carved 50, I thought, against United Arab Emirates, with having a good partnership with Dinesh Ramadhan. And then, well, other than that, they have some very good all-rounders in the form of Andrew Russell and Darren Sammy. And Lendl Simmons is also another very, very good player who comes in the lower middle order to give that sort of a real push to the scoring, Lendl Simmons. Now, Dwayne Smith, I think, Dwayne Smith for me, after seeing the way Johnson Charles batted, and especially considering this is a quarter final, I would say that probably Dwayne Smith might have to miss this opportunity, and Johnson Charles and Chris Gayle would have to open the innings. Dinesh Ramadhan, as you know, he's a very, very good bat, no doubt about it. Andre Russell and Darren Sammy are pretty good all-rounders. Now, the bowling of Kemar Roose the other day against United Arab Emirates, when Jason Holder reduced them to 46 for 6, probably one thought that, you know, Kemar Roose is the one who's going to bowl out the UAE below 100. But, to look at that, Kemar Roose was absolutely rusty, I thought. He leaked a lot of runs, and that was not something which was expected from Kemar Roose, such a frontline bowler. Now, Jason Holder, the bowling is in some good hands. Jason Holder, now Kemar Roose has to really get it up a gear, because now he'll be bowling against some superior opposition like New Zealand. Then they have Sulaiman Ben. Whether one probably gets the feeling that Sulaiman Ben would play in that particular match, because New Zealand have not, I would say, not a big fallibility, but definitely a spinner would be something that West Indies could really you know, take on, I suppose. In the sense, West Indies could have a spinner in the rank, Sulaiman Ben. I think this is going to be another good match. But the one thing I can tell you, looking at it, it looks like New Zealand are looking absolute favourites, no doubt about it, the co-hosts of the tournament. But West Indies, I think they are capable of springing a surprise. As you know, nobody gave a chance to West Indies, and here you see West Indies with a new captain, missing the big names. They are right there in the quarterfinals. So that definitely says the amount of hard work they have done. And you never know if tomorrow it is going to be Chris Gayle's day, where he's going to go bonkers. New Zealand might not be New Zealand might be put in a searching position here. So, but well, as I said, nothing can be said. But New Zealand definitely favourites, because they are looking pretty good, even though you know, Bangladesh stretched them. Well, dear fans, subscribers, as I said, this was a cricket show which was done. Basically, this was a cricket show which had to be done tomorrow. But tomorrow, whatever the show which was there for tomorrow, I have done it right now by completing my preview of the quarterfinals in this ICC Cricket World Cup 2015. Hope you all enjoyed it as much as I did, and thank you for your constant company to the Cricket Happening Show and your constant support to the Cricket Happening Show. Your host Ram will probably not be seeing you tomorrow, as I said, but on day after tomorrow, I'll be seeing you with a match report on the match between the first quarterfinals, which would be taking place between Sri Lanka and South Africa at the Sydney Cricket Ground. Until then, this is your host Ram signing off. Thank you.